for organizing this symposium and bringing us together to speak about Aleppo. I'll be speaking to you today about I'll present a simple analysis for the reconstruction of old Aleppo specifically. But in order for us to be able about talking about the reconstruction of old Aleppo, we need to understand first what happened there, how it happened, and to understand the prospects of the reconstruction and the actors that may be involved. Starting with the uprising, in 2011 the people of Syria marched for their freedom and demanded political reforms in the system that has been controlling them for over four decades. And the protests that started from Daraa in the south spread quickly across the country, and they were faced with a very violent response by the government that turned these protests into armed confrontation that reached the northern city of Aleppo in 2012. As soon as the confrontations reached Aleppo, the opposition managed to control the eastern side of the city, while the regime managed to keep its hold on the western side. And that turned the old city of Aleppo a contested zone separating the two halves. And that was specifically alarming for several reasons. One is the high density of the population in the old city. Two is the very rich history of the city, which we saw in earlier presentations. And finally is the markets of the old city that make it a very, very commercially vital hub in Syria. And affecting these centers could affect the economy not only of Aleppo, but of entire Syria. Indeed, in the start of the summer of 2012, we woke up one day to see that the tanks of the regime are actually wandering around the citadel, and we knew then that things are not well. The confrontations immediately started around the citadel, as both sides were competing to control this elevated asset because it overlooks all of Aleppo, and the regime was able eventually to control it along with several other buildings surrounding it. And that pushed the confrontations to the western axis of the old city, which is the old market, the covered market of old Aleppo. And simultaneously with that, confrontations were also happening in Al-Jdeideh quarter in the northwestern part of old Aleppo, which is also a very significant quarter of old Aleppo. And starting from then, the armed opposition managed to infiltrate in the rest of old Aleppo, and accordingly the conflict engulfed this ancient enclosure. Now the conflict was happening in old Aleppo from 2012 until 2016. And during the first couple of years of this conflict, there were three types of primary hazards. And by primary hazards, I mean hazards that are caused immediately, directly by the conflict. And these were weaponry, shelling, and bombardment. And these primary hazards caused different level of damage to the old city. Some of it was minor, like just maybe gunshots. Some of it was moderate, as we see here in Al-Shaybani Church, where we see moderate damage that is not really affecting the structural stability of the asset. And some of it was severe, like we see here in Suustiya, which is the market of the goldsmith in the covered markets of Aleppo, where we can see that the ceiling of the market completely collapsed. Now, during the second half of the conflict in old Aleppo, the primary hazards intensified as both the regime and its opponent embarked on using very, very extremely vicious methods against their opponents. The opposition started using the explosive tunnel method, which is basically mainly surrounding the citadel. And once they reached this specific asset, they would pile like huge amount of dynamites, and they would blow them up until the building, like this here, we see the Ottoman National Hospital, which became in the modern days a hotel, that the building completely collapsed, except for a small part of its western wing that is still standing. And that was the fate of several buildings in Aleppo. On the other hand, the regime started using the barrel bomb method, which is practically just barrels filled with explosives and harmful small materials like nails, for example. And one barrel bomb can cause severe damage that can wipe out several buildings at once. And here we can see an example of a part of Al-Farafra neighborhood in Old Aleppo, which is also a very significant neighborhood. And we can see the impact of the barrel bombing of the neighborhood. Now, alongside the primary hazards of the conflict, there were also secondary hazards, which are indirectly caused by the conflict. And they also caused severe damage to the old city. Some of them is fire, which comes after bombardment. And we can see here Bab al-Nasr Street, which was known for its beautiful wooden facades. And after three barrel bombs in July 2015, the street not only severely damaged, but also the fire swept through it, and it was flaming for 3 days. And eventually, all of the wooden facades were completely lost. We have also looting. Conflicts are also a time of security gaps, so systematic looting during these times. And we see here an example of the folklore museum, where we can see that not only the objects on display were looted, but also the beautiful wooden panels covering the walls were also looted. Also, what caused the damage to Old Aleppo, or triggered or intensified the damage, was lacking the maintenance, was lacking the competent, and is still lacking competent teams to respond in times of bombardment or severe damage. We have also, unfortunately, extremist ideologies. During 2014, Al-Nusra Front, which is an Al-Qaeda affiliated group, they managed to vandalize 3 different mosques inside Old Aleppo. And here we can see them in Al-Tiltawiyya Mosque, where the body of a prominent imam, prominent scholar, was buried. And they are taking out the remains of his body. And their justification was that they can't let people worship the dead. Finally, we have the weather, of course. The weather of Aleppo is known to be very cold and wet during winters and very hot and dry during summers, which means that these cycles of fluctuations of temperatures can escalate the cycles of deterioration to the cultural heritage of Aleppo, especially that lots of buildings are partially destroyed, which means that they're exposed to the weather. Finally, in 2016, the combat stopped in Old Aleppo after the regime imposed a siege on the eastern side of Aleppo, including Old Aleppo, and eventually the armed opposition surrendered and they were evicted out of the city. But unfortunately, 40,000 people of the of the eastern side of Aleppo were forcibly evicted with these fighters. Now, after the conflict, how was the response? The response was in 2 different categories. First is the assessment done by UNESCO. So UNESCO did emergency assessment on ground, and they also did some remote assessment through cadastral images. And here we see that according to the report of the remote assessment, that 11% of the cultural heritage of Old Aleppo is destroyed, almost 20% is severely damaged, and and over half of it is moderately damaged. On the ground, there were projects that immediately launched, like, for example, the stabilization of the bridge entrance to the citadel. We have also the restoration of the Mayad Mosque, which Frederick spoke about. And we have also some kind of small restoration for one of the ancient markets of Old Aleppo, Su'afiyo. And additionally, the local teams are still doing detailed assessment. But apart from that, really, Old Aleppo lies in ruins. Now, when we speak about reconstruction process, we need to understand who are the actors that we anticipate that will be part of this reconstruction process. And this can be divided into three categories. Primary actors, those include the local community who live inside the old city, or those who live outside of it but who have properties within it. We have the local agencies like the Director General of Antiquities and Museums. We have the consultants, workers, or contractors who will be directly working on the cultural heritage of the old city. We have secondary actors, and that is the rest of the population of Aleppo. We have international agencies, like, for example, the Al-Khan. We have humanitarian agencies who will be working on different subjects other than cultural heritage within the old city, and we need to coordinate with them. And we have eventually third actors, and those could be different groups or countries that could claim rights over specific assets within the old city for different reasons. Now, analyzing the reconstruction process. Reconstruction process could be, for the heritage specifically, could be a great opportunity for first delivering the needed measures to mitigate the damage to the old city and stabilize its assets. It could be a great way for enforcing social cohesion and initiating the reconciliation process, as cultural heritage can be a middle ground where everybody can meet. It could be also great for building the capacities of the community and getting them involved in the reconstruction process. It could be also a way for initiating long-term development projects that can help the people stand again. And it could be also time to adapt to regulations that are more effective and transparent, and we can do that through test strategies. However, looking at the old city of Aleppo from this perspective, we can see that it has strength and it has weaknesses to it. Its strength is the very strong cultural identity of the people of Aleppo, like Nasser was saying, the food, the music, the physical structure of the city are also very, very important for the people, and they're so very proud of them, especially the food. And the people are really willing to contribute to the reconstruction process. The demographics, Aleppo, like the rest of the Arab world, it's very, its population is young, it's diverse, it has great professionals and academics through its who can really assist in this process. In terms of the funding, the international community is very focused at the moment on Aleppo, so probably we can secure donors. The long history of the commercial vitality of Aleppo can be great way to support this process. And finally, in terms of legality, we have an already established directorate and law that regulate the structural and architectural interventions of Old Aleppo. However, we have weaknesses. First is the sheer damage of Old Aleppo. I think that the assessment of UNESCO fails to give a comprehensive assessment for the damage in Old Aleppo, because the damage is beyond the cultural heritage of the city. It also includes over 16,000 residential units that are among the old city, and those are also severely damaged. We have the population. The population of Aleppo is extremely weak. have been starved to death, literally. They have been they are suffering from poverty, from death, from abduction. They have been also, thousands of them, as mentioned earlier, have been forcibly evicted. So there is, these people are very weak and they can't really face the threats of the reconstruction process, as we will talk about. Also, what the people have faced was a drop, a sharp drop in the population. So there is a lack in the capacities. There is also the local institutions, they're very shaken after the conflict, which is normal. In terms of the funding, the Syrian economy is completely broken down. And in terms of the donors, actually I don't think securing donors is as easy, because donors are always connected to the media. And once there is a new catastrophe somewhere in the world, the media will go there and donors will follow the media. Finally, in terms of the law, the Syrian system is known for being so corrupted, so hierarchical. The people don't really trust their government, and eventually there is a lack in having regulations that correspond to this post-conflict situation. So, in conclusion, is there threats to the success of the reconstruction process of the old city? Yes, of course, because cultural heritage has always been its preservation and representation has always been bound by political, ideological, and economic factors. And the case of Syria, including old Aleppo, of course, it's no different. While these two might not be the only threats to the success of the reconstruction process, but they do consist the main threats to it. The regime, starting with the economics of the reconstruction process can be highly profitable. And so the regime is really, really trying to control this process, to make gains out of its profits. So, for example, Rami Makhlouf, who is the Bashar al-Assad's cousin and the face of the economy in Syria, has announced that he had already established a reconstruction company, development company, and that they're ready for the reconstruction process. And like Frederick was mentioning, also Samir Foz, another Syrian businessman, has also announced the same. On the other hand, Russia has been trying really hard to be part of reconstructing specific cultural landmarks in Syria. And those are like Palmyra. They have proposed several proposals to reconstruct Palmyra, and now the reconstruction of the Umayyad Mosque, as Frederick mentioned again, it's sponsored by the Chechen Republic, which we all know that it's a federal subject of Russia. We have also the this lotem that they made, which means that which is a very, very dangerous thing, because it means that the reconstruction of the cultural heritage of the city can literally be used as a weapon to first reshape the structure, the social structure of the city. So by that they can break this mass of people who dared to challenge the regime and who have already been displaced. And in another turn, it can be also a way for them to expropriate large areas of old Aleppo and conduct maybe huge development projects like that of Beirut, which was also mentioned earlier. So this can be very damaging to the cultural heritage, because that means extracting it out of its context. That can mean also enforcing the political and social division. It could mean nepotism and putting those favored in charge of the reconstruction process regardless of their professional or skilled qualifications. It could mean corrupted channeling of funding money, and it could mean just harming the cultural heritage of the city on very on several levels. Now, can we help? Yes, definitely. We can do that either by adopting people-centric methodologies or adopting, like pushing the institutions that we work with to adopt long-term development projects, or giving, even if that was very dreamy, maybe we can do something as simple as giving voice to those silenced, like for example, maybe conducting questionnaires with the people. And this has already been done by the Aleppo project, so maybe we can coordinate with them. We can also advocate for establishing a cluster for culture among the cluster system, which is an approach adopted by the UN in 2005 to provide a regulated and accountable response to basic human needs in times of crisis. So hopefully we can push to create a cluster for culture. And no matter how we can contribute, definitely we can monitor this process in a critical way and point out what's gone wrong. And no matter how we are being part of this reconstruction process, we always, always